Hello guys, welcome to part 4 of our unit on GI surgery. Before I move on with the lecture, I'd like to add a disclaimer that I do not own any of the pictures or illustrations I have used in this video. Now we're going to be talking about Barrett's esophagus. Barrett's esophagus is a condition characterized by the change of the normal lining epithelium of the esophagus by a lining epithelium which is similar to the intestine. Now, the normal lining epithelium of the esophagus is stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium. And in case of Barrett's esophagus, it changes into non-ciliated simple columnar epithelium with goblet cells. Hence, we define Barrett's esophagus as metaplasia of esophageal squamous epithelium to columnar epithelium. Now let's discuss pathology of the condition. Barrett's esophagus is mostly a complication of reflux disorders such as GERD and sliding hiatal hernia. For more details of the mechanism of how exactly this happens, I'd suggest you guys to check out part 2 of this unit. So it's mostly a complication of reflux disorders like GERD. And sliding hiatal hernia. Now let's discuss the risk factors of the condition. The major risk factors of Barrett's esophagus is alcoholism, age over 50, central obesity, and first degree family members who have suffered from Barrett's esophagus or esophageal cancer. Clinical features. Typically, symptoms are similar to GERD itself. So, the patients present with long-standing heartburn. Rarely, the patients will present with complications of GERD, such as esophageal peptic ulcer and esophageal strictures. Now let's talk about investigation. The American College of Gastroenterology recommends screening for Barrett's esophagus. Their recommendation is that a male over the age of 50 who has been suffering from GERD for over 5 years, plus there is also presence of two or more of the other risk factors that we discussed. Keep in mind that women do not need to be screened for this condition. Now, how exactly do we screen these patients? We go for endoscopy and biopsy. Where at least 8 random samples are taken, and once the Barrett's is detected, we confirm this with a second pathologist as well. Now, once we have confirmed that the patient has Barrett's, there are 3 possible scenarios. Either this is just the metaplasia has occurred and dysplasia has not yet happened. So that will be the first scenario. In these cases, we just give them high doses of proton pump inhibitors and reassure the patient. But if low grade of dysplasia is present, then we have 2 choices. Either we can recommend the patient to have frequent endoscopic monitoring until his low grade turns into a high grade. So first option would be a frequent endoscopic monitoring. Or we can directly suggest the patient to go for radiofrequency ablation. And the third scenario would be a high-grade dysplasia. In case of a high-grade dysplasia, we directly go for radiofrequency ablation. with routine surveillance. Now keep in mind that PPIs are given in all these stages. Now let's talk about complications. The complications of Barrett's esophagus mainly involves dysplasia and adenocarcinoma. Also, esophageal ulcers and esophageal strictures. Here's a list of abbreviations I have used in this lecture. And that concludes this lecture. Thank you for watching.